हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. सो वील जस्ट क्विकली रिकैप इन व्हाट वी डिस्कस इन द लास्ट क्लास. सो वी वर बेसिकली डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द डिस्क हार्ड ड्राइव, द हार्ड ड्राइव एंड बेसिकली ज्योमेट्री ऑफ द हार्ड ड्राइव, बिकॉज इन ऑर्डर टू ड्राइव द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ हाउ फाइल सिस्टम इज डेवलप्ड एंड हाउ डिस्क शेड्यूलिंग हैपन्स. सो वी वर बेसिकली डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द इंटरनल्स ऑफ हार्ड डिस्क. And we basically discussed this thing, how the internal of a hard disk look like. So there are several platters which are basically made of some hard material like aluminium and coated with magnetic film, so that data can be stored by inducing magnetic charges in it, and basically stored in sectors. So each sector is of typically 512 bytes, and each platter will have thousands and thousands of tracks. Each track is divided into sectors, and there is a disk arm for each surface. And there is a at the top of the disk arm is called disk head, which basically is responsible for reading and writing or inducing a charge. So the disk head has to be positioned at the right place in the at the right sector and right track in order to read and write data onto the corresponding track of the hard disk. And generally, this disk arm are connected to some kind of a motorized thing which helps to move the disk arm to and fro from the inner track to the outer track. And all these platters are basically piled up and connected to a spindle, which is also basically connected to some kind of a motor which rotates at very fast rate, so that basically different sectors can be read. So we basically showed an example what all things has to happen. So let us say the current head position is at the starting of the sector 21, and it has to, let us say, read sector 12. So first of all, the head has to be shifted from the outer track to the inner track, and then a rotation has to happen. So rotation in this case, we are assuming in anti-clockwise direction. A rotation has to happen so that the sector 12 comes under beneath the head, beneath the disk head. So this way, basically, this is an animation showing. So the disk arm basically moves to the right track, starts moving to the right track, and generally this will involve some kind of an acceleration, deacceleration, and all those things, because it's all mechanical movement. So when motor starts, basically it will accelerate, and then when it has to stop at the corresponding track, it will deaccelerate. So it is going to be an expensive movement. It takes time actually to synchronize all that. And at the same time, the rotation also is happening because the sector 12 has to come beneath this head. So rotation happens till this point, and now we can see that disk head is basically positioned at the starting of the sector 12. So now the data will start transferring. If whatever read or write has to happen, will start getting transferred till the end of the sector is reached. So we can see that there are in this complete operation, there are three components of the total time that requires for the completion of this input output. So first is this called seek time, which basically is the time which is required to move the head to the correct track, to the desired sector. So the desired sector may be on the inner track or outer track, and the disk arm has to move from one track to other. So that movement of the arm from one track to other is called the seek time. And then rotational latencies will be another component of the IO time, which will be required for the disk to spin to the correct sector. So after the disk arm is on the correct track, still there has to be some rotation, like as we saw in the previous example, in order to bring the correct sector beneath the track, beneath the reading arm. And finally, the data transfer time. And as you can see, the actual data actual time we are interested is in this data transfer. These are more mechanical movement, and these are kind, we can say these are kind of an overhead basically, that is needed for every read and write operation. And generally these are going to be more expensive. You can see these will be few milliseconds, and whereas this transfer time will be of the order of microsecond. So because these are actually mechanical movement, as you can see, this disk is a mechanical device which requires basically mechanical movement of the surfaces, the platters and the disk arm. So generally this will be more expensive than the data writing and reading and writing time. So we will see later on in today's class, we have to somehow minimize this overhead in order to optimize our IO. And how we will do that, we'll come to that probably in the second half of today's class. But first let us try to understand how this total IO time will look like. So it will be basically the sum of all these three components: seek time, rotation time, transfer time. And once you know the IO, the total time that is required to complete an IO, the rate of IO can be calculated, or this is basically throughput, can be calculated just, sorry, as the total amount of the data that was transferred upon the total time that was taken to complete that transfer. So that is called your rate of IO or throughput. So generally we compare disk with this parameter, what is the throughput of a disk, how good a disk is, but we can compare by using this rate of IO transfer. And we will see that there is no secret behind this, that the sequential access will be the rate of sequential access will be far more than the rate of random access, because the time taken to complete a sequential access will be much less, because obviously the seek time and rotation time will be minimized when you are reading a data in a sequence, whereas when you are doing reading in a random order from one track, jumping around, if your data is scattered all over the disk in different sectors, and if you are jumping around from one track to another track, then of course the time of the IO will be more, because your seek time and rotation time will be high, and therefore the rate of random access will be less. So unlike your RAM memory, which is random access memory, where ideally speaking accessing any location is equivalent, the time of access is same, disk is different. Disk will have is not a random access memory kind of thing. So it will be very important to basically organize our read and write request, so that, okay, let us come to those things, then I think we'll become more clear. So I have taken this example from the book just to get a feel of how this different type of transfers will take different amount of time for different types of hard disk. So this example from the book is basically based on a popular brand of hard disk, which is your Seagate drives. So Seagate is one of the market leader in hard disks, and it has different types of devices and the types of hard disks. Some are high performance disk, which are generally is called SCSI drives, and some are more commodity disks, which are called SATA devices. So this older technology, this more recent, more relevant, these are more faster hard drive, and these are less faster, but these are cheaper. So this is more faster. I think the specs will tell you what it is, but these are more cheaper. SATA drives are much cheaper than SCSI drives. And if you see the specs of these drives, the rotation per minute, so how fast the disk can rotate, this SCSI drive can rotate with 15,000 RPM, 15,000 rotations per minute, whereas the SATA drive can rotate max up to 7,200 rotations per minute. And the average seek time, which is your disk, which is your movement of your disk arm or disk head, on an average, it takes 4 milliseconds on this SCSI drive, whereas it takes 9 milliseconds on the SATA drive. and the maximum transfer rate of transfer difference is not so much. The SATA drive is 105 MB per second and this is 125 MB per second. So the main difference you can see is in the rotational, in the mechanical movement part. This SATA drive is much slower than this SCSI drive in the rotation and the seek time. The transfer time also it is lesser, but the difference is not of that order. Here the difference is almost 2x difference is there in this part, and here we have less difference. So let us try to compare how these drive will perform with respect to different type of read write request. So we will first take a random access. Let us say we are randomly making readings or writing some sectors of small IO. So we are purposely taking small IO, maybe 4 kilobyte. Still, it will be multi sector because one sector will be only 512 bytes. So at least it will involve 4 or 8 sectors, even if you have to read 4 kilobyte. But we are assuming we are reading, let us say we read a 4 kilobyte of data from random locations. So how long it will take with this Cheetah device, which is your SCSI device. So Cheetah and Barracuda is the name that the Seagate company gives to their this different segments of your hard drive. So with this one, we can see we can use these specs to calculate the seek time, rotation time, and transfer time for 4 kilobyte random access. So seek time, already the company's specifies on an average peak time is 4 milliseconds, so we'll take that. Although in practice it will be more than that, they have just specified a average seek time. In practice, if you have to move from the outermost to the innermost, it will be more than this. But here we are only concerning in calculating an average IO time, just to get a just for comparison's sake. So we will take the average seek time is your 4 milliseconds, which is specified by the company itself. How do you calculate the average rotation time? So on average, we will assume the disk has to rotate half the time that it takes to rotate one complete full rotation. So full rotation takes, let us say, R. So we will say average rotation will, on an average case, it will take R by 2. So in this case, the average rotation is computed as 1 by 2 of your total R. And how do you calculate this R? You have to calculate using this rotation per minute. So if you remember our pre-JE preparation, especially in chemistry and all that, whenever you had to do these computations and we had to deal with different units, we'll do this kind of dimensional analysis to basically get the right units. So same thing we are doing here. So it says you can compute 15,000 rotations per minute. So it takes 1 minute per 15,000 rotations. So one rotation will take 1 by 15,000 minute. Now minute has to be, normally we want the time in milliseconds. So again, we basically multiply 60 seconds and then 1,000 milliseconds. And you know, this units get canceled basically, and you're left with 2 millisecond as an answer. Of course, there's nothing here to explain. But what we are basically calculating is calculating the value of R by 2, where R is the time taken to rotate your disk for one full rotation in milliseconds. And this is the way just the calculation is being shown. And the transfer time, how much will take for transferring 4 kilobyte? So max transfer, peak transfer rate is given 125 megabytes per second, and you have to transfer 4 kilobytes. So you can again calculate using the same kind of analysis. So 1 second it takes to transfer 125 megabyte. So to transfer 4 kilobyte, you multiply by 4 KB. And again, to get the right units, 1 megabyte is equivalent to 1024 kilobyte. And then microsecond, you will get the values in microsecond basically. which is much less than milliseconds that we get. With the rotation, we got 2 milliseconds, and time was 4 milliseconds. But this transfer time is just a microsecond, so it is negligible as compared to the other two time. So I hope the calculation part should be okay, understandable by everyone. It's nothing different what we are doing here, just getting the right unit. So the total time, that means, is 4 + 2 + 31 microsecond, which is roughly equal to 6 milliseconds only, which is basically the same as your the overhead time. So overhead time is totally dominating the actual transfer time here. So with random access, this is what is going to happen. If you're randomly accessing different sectors, the actual time to reach to the desired sector, which is much larger than the actual data transfer time. So your overhead time will always dominate in this case. And how do you calculate the throughput? Throughput is basically your rate of I/O, is basically your transfers, your size that you have transferred upon the total time that you have taken. So that is what we are calculating. We transferred 4 kilobyte in 6 milliseconds. So that gives you 0.66 megabytes per second. So again, changing kilobyte to megabyte and milliseconds to seconds. I think there is some mistake here. It should be 1000 milliseconds. Yeah. So you can calculate. I think this should come out. I have taken this date, the final result I have taken from the book only. So you can just verify later on whether it is right or not. But it comes out to be 0.66 megabyte per second for doing a random read or write of 4 kilobyte. We can do the same calculation with the SATA device, again for random 4 kilobyte. So seek time is given already 9 milliseconds. Rotation, again we can calculate R by 2 using this 7200 value now. So it comes out to around 4.16 milliseconds. And transfer time, again using this 105 as the transfer rate, that comes out to be 37 microseconds. Again here, if you calculate the total mechanical movement time is 9 + 4.16, and the transfer time is just 37 microsecond. Again, this is far greater than the actual transfer time. So your total transfer time is almost equivalent to the overhead. So it comes out to be 13.2 millisecond, and the rate of I/O, the throughput, comes out to be 0.31 megabytes per second. So if we try to summarize this calculation and try to compare the two drives, we'll get some idea. So we have tried to see a random workload and a sequential workload. A random workload we have seen using 4 kilobytes. If we take a sequential workload of, let us say, 100 megabytes, a large I/O in a sequence, so you are just using consecutive sectors from the disk of size 100 MB. In that case, you can also calculate for sequential. The transfer time will take 800 milliseconds for 100 MB in the case of the SCSI drive. And in case of your SATA drive, it takes around 950 milliseconds. The difference is not very significant. It is there. And your total I/O time will be the same as seek plus rotation plus transfer time, which comes around 806. And for the SATA, again 9 + 4.16 + 950, which comes around 963. So here you can see the transfer time, the overhead is much less. Overhead is only 6 milliseconds, and the actual transfer time is 800 milliseconds. So here, when we are doing a sequential access, we are spending most of time in actual data transfer rather than moving our arm to the right sector. So in this case, we are actually reaching our peak, rate of I/O. Peak transfer rate, which is, so if you remember, the maximum transfer rate was this only, and the rate of throughput is almost reaching the peak value when we are doing a sequential transfer. Whereas when we were doing a random transfer, our rate of throughput was just very marginal 0.66 megabyte per second and this 0.31 megabytes per second. So there are two things obviously to understand. One is definitely if we scatter our data all around, if we do read and write from arbitrary locations, we are going to, your performance will be very slow in compared to if we do sequential access. And also we have to try to, instead of doing a read and write from small units of sectors, it will be good if we can merge multiple IO requests in a large chunk, which are almost consecutively or sequentially located. So instead of doing small random IOs, we will try to perform large sequential IOs in order to get the maximum throughput. And you can also understand why SCSI drives are a little costly, because you can see that there is almost a difference two times. Even with access, this SCSI drive is performing two times better than this SATA drive. Is this why it takes a lot of time to copy a large amount of very small files? Yes, exactly. So if you remember, if we zip a file, if we have small files, and if we do a zip, if we zip all of them into one file and then do a transfer, it gets transferred very quickly. But if we don't zip them, and then most of those files may be stored at different arbitrary locations. And when you copy all of them, you can see it almost takes a magnitude many order of time. So if you compare this 0.66 with 125 megabits per second, and I think it's a factor of 200 times, more than 200 times slower. So that's what we experience when we try to copy small files, many of such small files instead of one zip file. So it's always better if you have to keep on transferring some data from files from one disk to other, from one location to other locations. It's always recommended to zip them even before you actually try to do a copy operation. So that was a good observation, Varun. I think that helped the discussion to understand why this is all basically working like that. So, but now what we are coming to this point, so because considering these factors, how we do our different IOs will matter a lot in our speed. So OS, we cannot do random IOs. OS has to get involved in ordering our IO, various IO requests. Otherwise, the system will get very slow, especially whenever there's an IO operation. So that is our next topic of scheduling various read and write requests or IO requests. Right now we are just worried about disk only. So how to schedule different read and write requests coming to the disk? And it's obvious to understand that we should not do simple first in, first out, the way the first come first serve. We should not do that, because the request may not always come in a sequential manner. They may be random. So most of the disk requests to disk are basically reordered with other. So normally a buffer is kept, a queue is maintained of multiple read and write requests. Then our scheduler basically goes through those multiple requests and tries to reorder them, schedule them using some policy, some optimal policy, which will basically give you the best performance. And the goal will be to minimize seek time and rotational delay. That is, we will try to read and write blocks in larger chunks and in sequence as far as possible. So that will be the goal of a best disk scheduling policy, which it will try to merge multiple read and write requests in. So if the request comes, let us say a 30 sector, and then let us say 2 sector, and then 31, and then maybe 12, and then 32, and so on. So it will reorder them. It will try to merge this 30, 31, and 32 basically into a single request of maybe a one request of 3 sectors, and then the remaining one. So all those things has to be done trying to basically optimize our disk performance. But the problem is that OS cannot do it directly, because Generally, as we have seen, because of our abstraction, our file system abstraction, in order to be able to handle different types of hardware devices, there is an abstraction layer of abstraction built in into the OS. And generally, the disk internals are hidden away from the OS. So what OS does, it leaves the task of this read-write scheduling to a disk controller. So normally, within every hard disk, there is a small hard software and a device. There is a device controller, and that device controller will have a scheduling algorithm running on it based on the inputs from the OS. Because disk scheduler, disk controller will know the disk internals exactly, whether it is a SCSI drive or this SATA drive, and where that drive is good at, and what all those things, and how fast is the seek time, how fast is the rotation time, because all those factors will have to be incorporated in order to optimize our scheduling. So generally, all those details may not be available, may not be known to OS. So OS leaves this task to the disk scheduler, which is basically a software running in the disk controller of the hard disk. So disk scheduler decides which IO request to schedule next. So from the queue of various requests, basically, it will look into it and it will schedule them. One important thing to notice here is, unlike job scheduling, when we were doing CPU scheduling, and the OS scheduler basically, when it has to do the shortest job first, that was kind of an optimal one, some kind of an optimal policy. But the problem with shortest job first was we did not knew in advance how much time each job will take. But in this scenario, quite slightly different. Here, the disk scheduler might be able to predict or guess how long our disk request will take, because based on the current position where it is and where the new sector is, it can calculate how much time it will take to move from here to here, and also it knows the transfer time. So it is not too difficult for the disk scheduler to estimate the total IO time that will take to satisfy one read or write request. So here we know, so it's quite possible to implement this kind of an optimal shortest job first kind of a scheduling algorithm. Difference here. If we do it to an OS, it will not be possible. But if we do it within the disk scheduler, in the disk controller itself, it is possible. So I will stop this PPT and I will move to. But any question till this point? Anybody wants to ask something here? Let me just pause for one minute. Think over it, what we have discussed. If anybody has any question, we'll discuss this. Because I'm going to use a simulator to drive our understanding of various scheduling algorithm for disk. Okay, so I think everybody has understood this. There is no question here, major question here. So let me come to the simulator that is given in Ramji's book at the end of the chapter. So as I've told earlier, every chapter has some kind of a program, a Python program, Python script, which basically helps to simulate some of the concepts in that chapter. So in this hard disk chapter at the end, there is a program called disk.python basically. So it has, if you see the help option, it has various options by which you can. It is actually, unlike the other simulator, it has a graphics GUI also. So you can see how the disk movement will happen and how different scheduling will happen. So I liked it, so I'm going to use that only to discuss different scheduling options. So there are different options in this simulator. You can change the rotation speed, the seek speed, and the policy, the scheduling policy that you want. We will be discussing all these policies. And the other algorithms I'll discuss in a second. Let me just show you the simulator first. And maybe I'll start with a simple one. I'm just specifying the request list. So I'm just right now trying to use to read a sector number 10, and dash G is basically showing the graphics, the simulator in the graphics mode. So if I run this program, the
other options are all default.
GUI is visible here. So basically, when you run with default, so unless you change, give some option, the other options are all default. So seek speed is one, rotation speed is one. So what it basically means is you have to see the read file to understand all these arguments. But it what basically means is rotation speed, for example, one means it will take one unit of time per angle of rotation. So if this 360 degree of rotation, so it will take almost 360 unit of time for full rotation in this case. And again, seek speed means one unit of time per unit distance. So here there are three tracks, and within between two tracks, I think they have taken a default distance of 40 units. So it will take 40 units from moving from one track to other track, and so on. Other arguments I'll explain later on. So let us try to see. So currently, as you can see, the disk arm is placed at the beginning of sector number 6. And the request that you have only one request to read the sector number 10 from 6 to 10. So here the time will increase. Here it, at the end of the request, it will tell how much seek time, how much rotation time was required, and how much transfer time was required. So I'll start the animation from by S. So if I click here and press the S button, so you can see I'll just pause. So it starts rotating, and because this is on the same sector, sector number 10 is on the same track, so it does not tries to, it does, there is no seek time here, it is simply rotating. So I'll just pause it. So you can see from 6 to 9, it has taken 79 units of time. So I think there are 12 sectors in per track here. So per sector, I think the angle is 30 degree. So from one sector to another sector, it will take 30 units of time. So if I continue here, so you can see when it came at the beginning of sector number 10, it became green, signifying that it is starting, it is basically starting the transferring of the data. And when it, so in between these two track, so we are assuming these are the, this is the start of this and this is the end of this sector. So the start and the end is between the two tracks. So this is one sector, which is your sector number 10. So you can see the total rotation time you can calculate. It was from 6 to coming to 10. It took, I think, 105 units. You can see here. And seek time was 0. And the transfer time, again, it took 30 units to transfer. So here, we are just, this is just a simulator. So the values may not actually correspond to the actual disk here, kind of thing. Just a simulator to see how scheduling, different scheduling algorithm will perform. So the total time in this case, it has calculated as 135 in order to read this block number 10. So I hope this simple example gave the idea of how this simulator is working. So let me try to see some. So I've already compiled some good cases. So now, instead of just reading 10, let us read two consecutive sectors, 10 and 11, in a sequence. So here in the queue, we have two jobs to reserve, sector number 10 and 11. Again, the starting is the same from 6. So if I start, default policies is reading. So again, so as you can see now, what it has happened, the same thing. Seek time again, both were on the same track, so 0-0. For block number 10, the rotation time was 105. For block 11, because it was consecutive, there was no rotation delay there. Immediately as 10 finished, 11 started, so there was no rotation delay. However, there was transfer time for both of the disk blocks, which is 30 units. So total time to satisfy both the requests is now 165. So I hope this was simple enough. Now let us see a slightly different. So I hope the numbers are visible in the in this GUI. So now we are trying to read 10, 11, and 12. All these are consecutive, but there is slight difference here. The outer track started from 0, ended at 11th. So there are so when you satisfy 10, 11, now there has to be a seek time. Now the disk arm has to move to the second track, inner track, and because 12 is starting after that. So there will be now some seek also. And there is one more point you will see here. So as you can see, 12 is not started any arbitrary. So instead of starting 12 here, we have started 12 here with some reason. And why that reason will be, will come clear now. I'll just start the simulator. So note 10 and 11 happen same like that. So in the same order, nothing much difference. But now start now the disk arm will know that it has to go to 12, so it will has to change to the track while the rotation is going on. So let me just continue. So have you noticed what happened? When it has to change track from 11 from this to this, because the moment it started accelerating and then it deaccelerating, it before it actually came to the second track, the because rotation was already going on, the entire full rotation was basically got 12 to come again. Time it reached, it came at 13th location rather than 12. So 12, he could not read 12. So he has to now wait for the entire full rotation in order for 12 to come again. So that is what has happened. I'll just show it again once more. So it has to wait for one more full rotation before it can read this sector 12. So you can see for block 12, now there was a seek time of 40 units from moving from one track to another, and a full, almost a full rotation, I think of 320 has to be there, has to be done, because by the time it actually came to that track, this sector had already passed from that head, from that location. So this problem can be, this problem happened because I think this the offset was not proper. Instead of starting 12 here, if you have started 12 at this location, then by the time the disk arm would have come here, it would have been able to it would have been able to immediately read from that sector instead of waiting for full one rotation. So depending on the seek time, the skewing has to be done, skewing of the sector numbers has to be done accordingly. Should I run this again? If people have not observed it, maybe let me just run it again. If you see, it started 10, then 11, and then before it actually moved to the inner track, 12 had already skipped. And if the seek time was more probably faster, then probably it could have been avoided. So this kind of arrangement of the sector would be good if seek time was a little faster than this. But for this kind, we may have to we can change the skewing little bit. So here I'm doing an off two sectors, adding an argument to this simulator where I'm trying to offset the sectors from one track to another by a difference of 2. So if you can see here, from 11, I am using a difference of 2 sectors before 12 starts, because I specified the option 2. So earlier there was only an offset of 1, or I think 0. Now we have specified an offset of 2. And now that problem will be rectified. If you see, it will start reading 10, 11, and by the time it actually comes, it is already safely, it is well before it comes before 12, it is already there. So some rotation still has to be there. It has to be waited. Probably just a offset of 1 was sufficient for this case. But again, so the arrangement of the sector has to be done depending on the seek speed and the rotation speed. So that was just an internal about this, nothing to do with scheduling. But this just wanted to help you understand why this kind of a pattern of offset of different sectors numbers is there on different tracks.
One more thing,
I hope anybody has any question, you can ask. So one more thing, in the normal simulator, what we are seeing is that we are doing an equal zoning. Basically, we are basically in the earlier simulator, if you had seen, we had same number of tracks in everything. So there are 12 sectors in the innermost as well as the 12 sectors in the outermost. But in actuality, different scenario will be there. In the outer sectors will have much more number of sectors than the inner sector because we have more space there. So this kind of a scenario will be a more realistic scenario. Here we have different sectors will have different angles covering here. So there are probably 25 sectors or 26 sectors in the outermost, and whereas only 12 sectors in the innermost. So in this case, for example, if you are trying to read a sequential access of from 16 to 21, now 16 to 21 is, I think, on the outermost track, 16 to 21. So if you read it, it will be a very simple no seek time, only some little bit in rotation time and all transfer time. So total 121 unit of time took in order to read, I think, 6 sectors on the outermost track. Whereas if we read same 6 sectors in an innermost track, the time will be different. So if you see inner time, first of all, it has to do a seek. And then in order to read these 6 sectors in the innermost track, it has to do more rotation. Even rotation time, if you see, there is rotation and transfer time is also more, 180 units of time for the same 6 sectors. In the earlier case, it was taking, I think, only 84 units of time. So that means you can get more bandwidth if you are reading in the inner sector rather than in the outer sector. So that also will determine your performance. If your data is stored somewhere in the outer sectors, you will get more bandwidth or more faster performance. But if your data is stored, or if you are writing it in the inner sectors of your disk, you may experience a little slower performance. And this simulator is actually doing all that things, so to help us understand those things. But let us come to the scheduling. That is what our main topic of today that we want to discuss in this part of the class. Any question till this point about the simulator or anything? So you can later on, you can run this simulator. It's available on the book website. You just have to install Python. And you'll be able to run it. Why is it taking more transfer time for? In the inner sector, because let me show you once more. The inner sector, there are less number of sectors inside in the inner sector and more number of sectors in the outer. So now if you have to let us read these 6 sectors, the total rotation that you have to do will be, the angle of rotation, total rotation will be larger. Whereas the same 6 sectors in the outers, so this will be probably maybe around 60 degree, whereas in the inner sector, it will be more around 100 or 120 degree. So more rotation has to be done to read that. So that is why it is taking more time in the inner sectors than the outer sector.
We'll start with Q4.
Okay, so okay, now let us come to scheduling algorithms, some simple scheduling things. Of course, we'll start with FIFO. FIFO, although it's not useful here, but just to what is Z? So this is basically a zoning option. So it is saying that for the inner sector, you have for one sector will take 15 degrees, I think, and the outer sector, the outermost sector will each sector will be on with a degree the angle of 15 degree, and this whereas the inner sector each sector will occupy an angle of 30 degree. If you see the angle from the center, I don't know the angle of inclination, what do you say in geometry? So I hope you understood the point. So as we see the in outer sector, there we have more sectors, so less angle. If I show in the I cannot write it here. I need to, I hope you got it. I will have to open OneNote to draw the diagram, but I think I'll just show it in this. So as you can see, this is a standard here. Here we are assuming both sector, whether it is inner or outer, each sector is taking just 30 degree of angle. But in the earlier case, when we change the zoning, outer sector would be taking less angle, whereas the inner sector will be making a larger angle. So that was just to because that is for the simulator has to know. That's how he will draw this disk here. So that's why for the simulator, we have to specify that angle in order to simulate the scenario of more number of sectors on the outer and inner and less on the inner. Okay, this angle will also affect transfer time. So actually it is actually affecting the transfer time that we saw in the simulator. The transfer time was more. If you see, in the inner sector, the transfer time per sector was 30 units. Whereas in the outer sector, the transfer time per sector was only 14 units because the angle was less. Okay, so yes. Okay, so now let us come to the scheduling algorithm. So now I've taken a simple request, some random request, 10, 30, 40 from different tracks. And by default, it takes FIFO policy. So I have not set any policy, so by default it is taking FIFO policy. So if we run this, so as you can expect, first it will serve 10 and then it will serve 30, so it will go to the innermost track, read it, transfer it, then it will come to the second track where 14 is residing and will wait for rotation to happen and then do a transfer. So you can see if each block needed some rotation, some seek time, because it was a random access and total time of unit was quite large, 615 units. So we can improve this with little bit better scheduling policy. So one method we can actually use is, see, 10 was on the outermost, 30 was on the innermost, and 14 was in the middle. So instead of so from after 10, instead of going serving 30, if we serve 14, which was anyhow on the path to 30, so from 10, if we first do 14, we'll have less, we'll reduce the seek time. We'll reduce seek time for serving these three requests. So we can reorder these requests by considering how much seek time it will take in order to serve those requests. So in this case, the natural choice would be after 10, instead of going directly to the innermost track, first go to the middle track, serve the request 14, and then go to the inner track 30 and serve it. So if you do that is called shortest seek time first. So with the same argument, with the policy SSTF, if I run this simulator and let us see how it will work. So same example, as you can see, first it will serve 10 and then it will try to serve 14. It will calculate that it will take minimum lesser time to serve 40, lesser seek time for 14. So after 10, 14 became highlighted. So it was trying to serve 14 first before 30. Although 30 came first, it tried to serve 14 first. So you can see the seek time was now was lessened, 40-40 only. Earlier it was taking 80 plus 40, which is what was 120. Now it has reduced to only 80, and you can see the total from 615, it has reduced the total time to 375. Other things also reduced because of that. So it is definitely a much better policy than FIFO. But what are some problems with this policy?
Because other classes are now finished, most of the courses. So I'll try to complete this topic. It will take another 20-30 minutes.
So students had requested me to take little longer class than 1 hour, because other classes are now finished, most of the courses. So I'll try to complete this topic. It will take another 20-30 minutes. So maximum 1.5 hour class today. I hope everybody is okay with it. If not, let me know now so that I'll stop earlier. Otherwise, I'll take 20-30 minutes, I think, and complete the scheduling policy. And the next class will start with file system itself. I'll also try to finish, wind up the course in this week itself then. If other courses are finished, so we'll try to wind up as fast as possible. As, of course, not compromising with the understanding. Can you please share this execution thing so that we can also try and do? Yeah, these queries. Yeah, I'll share this this text file. So these arguments you can actually run on your own and you can see. So what are the problems with this shortest seek time first?
But still it is falling short of two things. First of all, it is
so not shortest seek time is good in the sense it is better than FIFO. That it is at least trying to minimize seek time. But still it is falling short of two things. First of all, it is not accounting for rotation delay. It is only taking into account just the seek time. But we have seen that seek time and rotation times both are expensive time, and probably a better algorithm will try to take into account both seek as well as rotational delay. And those algorithms are called shortest access time or shortest positioning time, but basically they take into account both seek and rotation time. So for the same example, or I think it's a different example, we could have run the same example, but let us. So if I change the policy to this, which also takes into account rotation, let us see how it will perform. So the query is like this. We have to serve 7, 22 and 2. So 7 is on the outermost track, 22 is in the on the second track, and 2 is again on the outermost track. Okay. So if it was FIFO, it would have tried to serve 7 first, then 22, and then 2. If it was the shortest seek time first, what it would have done? It would have seen that, okay, 7 is here, but 2 is also on the same track. So instead of serving 22, it would have just waited for the full rotation to happen. And first it would have served this sector 2, and then it would have shifted to the inner track. But the problem is, you can see it is not taking into account the rotation, because from going from 6 to 2, it has to almost more than half of the rotation, whereas 22 is very, and then after 2 it has to again do a full rotation before it reads 22. So if we can try to run this this query with for both SSTF, and I think we are trying with the shortest access time first. So in this case, what it will do, it will be try to be a little more intelligent. So it will serve 7 and it will serve 22 first, because it will recognize that serving 22 will minimize the rotation as time. So it is trying to take into account both the seek time and rotation time. So instead of waiting for 2 to happen first and then going inside 22, it actually dynamically decided, let me go inside serve 22, then come back and serve 2. Let me just continue it and let us see how much time it took. So in this case, it took 2
only 255 units of time with the by taking into account both thing. Whereas if you don't do that, let me quit it. If I instead of shortest access time, if you do the same shortest seek time first and run it, so it will not go to 22. It will first serve 2, and then it will shift to 22. So although it tried to minimize seek time, but the total time has come much larger, 495. Because the rotation time in this case is too much, has become too much. It has almost done 2 rotations to fulfill this. So now I think Vanshika has asked a question which is very pertinent in this case. If seek time is very high as compared to rotation time, then is SSTF better? Yes. So now SSTF will, now the performance of SSTF will depend on, it's not always that SSTF will perform best, because the decision will depend on whether rotation is faster than seek or vice versa. So if seek time is faster, probably it may be better not to do that. Whereas if I hope you got the point. So whether to shift inside, whether to rotate, whether to do to change track or not, both things has to, not only the speed of the rotation and the speed of this movement of the disc of the arm, that has to be taken into account. So just to illustrate this, let us say on purpose I am reducing the skew speed, I'm making it very small, only 0.1, so it will change track very slowly, whereas the rotation speed I'm keeping the same. So for the same thing, for the same case, if I run it with a seek speed very slow, in this case, for example, if I run it, and I think this is what? So this is by default, I think it is taking FIFO only. Yeah, I did not change the policy. So so you can see here, maybe I'll just run it again. In this case, you can see the seek time has been made very slowly. So even if you try to move to the other disc, even shorter seek time first, if you have tried, it would not have been good with this case, because seek speed was too slow than the rotation speed. So even when it is trying to move, it is always skipping. It is missing the actual sector before it actually changes the track. So this on purpose, this is an extreme case. Normally in modern drives, the seek time and rotation time are roughly equivalent. So moving from one track to other and rotation, the speeds are roughly equivalent. But for implementation of the algorithm, you will have to take into account the rotation, not only the rotation time, but the speed of the rotation and speed of the seek. So so it's not an easy thing. We'll see later on to calculate this dynamically, to compute this optimal schedule dynamically. Although it's, as we said, we know the internal geometry, we know how long it will take, but still to do it dynamically, it's little bit it's not so easy. It's a little difficult thing. So with shortest positioning time, access time, ideally this algorithm will take into account both rotation speed and the seek speed, and both it will decide. So it will decide based on the addition of this. I think I've not written here, so I cannot write on this, but this will take into account both rotation plus seek time. Here, can it be? Yeah, it will take into account both rotation as well as, seek time. Bad luck, this is not meant for this, for writing anyhow. So
the shortest positioning time for Algorithm will take into account both the thing. I hope you got the point, and it will decide whether to change track or not based on the total of the seek and the rotation time. The second problem that this algorithm, this simple shortest seek time, is the starvation. In fact, both the algorithm, there is a problem of starvation that may happen if you try to optimize too much for incoming request. Then what may happen? Some of the request may get starved. And an example, let me run this. It will become more clear. So here I'm trying to bring after. So initial request came 10:13, and then I'm bringing some more request, and we'll see how this algorithm will perform. So initially they're 10:30. So let us say, so after 10, I think this algorithm is FIFO. No, this shorter seek time. So shorter seek time first we'll decide. Okay, 7 is on the same track. So it will next decide to basically serve 7. It will not go to 30, which is on the inside track. Now, but while it is serving 7, basically another request came 6. So again, it will decide, okay, I should keep on the same track. And then another, while it is serving 6, another request came 3, which is also on the same track. So what is happening? 30 is getting starved. And this may happen. So that starvation problem can basically occur in this case. So we are on purpose, we are keeping on the same track just to show, just to drive the point that these algorithms can make one or two requests starve for. So we can avoid that using some modification. So some algorithms do a scanning. So they basically start. So okay, whatever request came, they came. Now for newer request, it will not consider until unless it completes the scan. So it starts from one end to the other end. So once it starts moving from let us say outer to inner track, it will first complete one full scan before actually going back to the inner track. Another algorithm which says, I will share the slides, and in the book also you can read more details, but it's not so relevant. So another algorithm says bounded window. So it will keep a bound on the window size. So it will try to first calculate. So it, for example, if for the same problem, if you keep a bound window of 2, so it will force to serve 30 first before actually request, before try to serve the incoming request. So if we make a, let me just try to run this and show it. So this is a bounded shortest access time first. I'm trying to run here. So it will optimize in a window of 2. So it will consider 2 requests at a time before it considers the incoming request. So in this case, even though 7 came, but the window is of 2 only, so it will first serve 30. We'll force to serve 30 first, and then it will decide among 7 and 6. So among 7 and 6, now the window is shifted to this. So even though 3 may have been served first, but it will first serve 7 and 6 first, and then move to the next window. So that may, yeah, it may happen in SATF as well. So both the algorithms, this bounded window can be done in both the algorithms to avoid this starvation problem. So that is how we can deal with starvation. We can keep a finite windows, what we say a max, the upper bound on the number of requests to be served in a single window in order to avoid starvation. So different variations of those are there. But this is all different scheduling algorithms which are there, which actually happen. And one final point that I want to make is that even these shortest access time or positioning time first is not optimal. Because optimal, I think you are doing an algorithm course, and you know, right now it is doing a greedy method. Basically, it is taking into account the next. It is basically making a decision based on the next choice. But if you have to see an optimal algorithm will take into account all the requests simultaneously that may come in future. So that will require kind of a dynamic programming, which basically enumerates all possible sequences, all possible choices, and then decides which is the optimal route to serve. But that to do that in dynamically in real time is very, very difficult, because we know dynamic algorithms, dynamic programming, it's not easy to implement.
especially though greedy algorithms are very fast, but dynamic algorithms and the time complexity can grow exponentially unless it is implemented very intelligently. So a simple implementation of SATF and all that are not optimal. We cannot say they are optimal. They try to greedily take a greedy approach in just making a next decision to be smart. But the really smart decision will take into account all the possible requests together and finding an optimal route. So just to an example, of course, to come up with this example is not possible. You have to do on your own. Basically, you have to use some kind of computation to come up with this example. So let us see if let us try to run this. So in this case, I'm using a shortest access time first, even with a window of size maybe 10. That is not necessary, but and I'm taking these requests, this particular order of request. And if I run this. So it will basically dynamically, it will decide based on the positioning time and access time and all that. And we'll see how much total time it takes basically. It tries to be smart, but unfortunately it does not does the best job.
Total time it took around 1095.
It makes a greedy choice, which is good enough in a local window of time. So total time it took around 1095. But if I stop this, but if we run even a simple FIFO rather than a shortest access time, which does not tries to be smart in this case, that performs little better. In fact, that turns out to be more optimal.
But we'll see the outcome, total outcome we'll see. So total time taken in this.
So this one is, I think, doing a simple FIFO. But we'll see the outcome, total outcome we'll see. The total time taken in this way of serving the request incidentally comes out to be lesser than the more smarter SATF algorithm. So this one I think took 1065 and that one was 1095. So slightly better. So this dumb algorithm FIFO basically became better than the shortest access time first, which is trying to incorporate make a greedy decision. But as we know, greedy decision are not optimal in the overall window. You have to do a dynamic programming to do basically come up with the most optimal schedule. In this case, incidentally, by luck, FIFO came, the actual optimal schedule was just a FIFO schedule. So it's not, I'm not saying that FIFO is optimal, but what my point is that even SATF is not optimal, and to really implement an optimal schedule is quite challenging to do it in real time because that will involve a lot of computational overhead. And on this controller to do that, we are not doing it on the OS is not doing this. We have to do it in within the hardware. So I hope the point was clear. Of course, you don't need to understand everything what I've discussed. This these are just more details. Most of the books doesn't discuss all these details. But yeah, I think Ramji books gives a more detailed exposition. So I tried to do that. I'll be sharing this the simulator is already there, but this different options I will be sharing this. And the slide also I will be sharing. The slide basically does the same thing, explains those things. But I think it would not have explained, the slide would not have explained that to that degree the way the simulator explained. So I choose that method. So I'll be sending this slide also to you. In the next class, basically, I think we'll stop today's class. Any question till this point? Anybody has any point to make? Any question, any doubt? The next topic in Ramji's book is on RAID. I will skip that because it is not generally covered in a OS course in most of the syllabus. General a summary of that I have kept here in this slide. So generally for error detection and error correction, there are some extra bits stored on the disk
which helps us doing this detection and correction. Oh, let me just a question. Which policy is used by dish schedulers today? So normally they try to use the shortest positioning time first, because as I said, most drives, they try to optimize both seek time and rotation time, and they're roughly equivalent. So the best algorithm which works is kind of the shortest positioning time, which takes into account both the rotation plus seek times, and makes a greedy choice. It basically looks in the next which is the best optimal, which request should I start next, which will give me the least rotation and seek time, and because that can be done quickly, it doesn't take a lot of computation, and that is what is done in most of the modern drives. But I don't know, maybe the more advanced high performance drive may be doing a more dynamic programming, maybe, but I doubt it may. I am not sure, so that I need to I'll try to do a more research on that and let you know. But most of the drives that we used in our systems, and even probably in data centers, are those SCSI and SATA drives, and they all use your shortest positioning time first. Okay, that was a good question. So I'll wrap up this topic with this finally. So there are some methods to correct some of the errors, to detect if there is a data corruption, some sectors has been corrupted or not, using this additional bits. So if those bits get flipped, then you can know that, okay, there is some corruption of data. And this our controller OS can blacklist those sectors so that it will not further read or write from those sectors. So in that way, even if there are partial failures or partial corruption of the some sector, disk can still function. But if the entire disk fails, then your system can crash. So to avoid that, there are technologies called RAID, where instead of just one disk, we have a redundant array of inexpensive disks. And they are basically arranged with some hardware and software, which basically keeps a copy of the data on additional disks, so that if one disk fails, the other disk starts, can provide the data and so on. And so they basically replicate the data across multiple disks, and they provide high reliability and performance. So if somebody is more interested, he can read that chapter. It's easy to read on your own. It's not, there's no difficult thing there, but I will not go through it because I don't want to increase the syllabus, as well as it's not generally asked in most of the details are not asked in any exams. Maybe you may be just asked about what is RAID and why it is used. So for that purpose, I've just kept this slide here. So I hope we have covered this. So final topic that we'll be discussing is your file system. That will take one or two class, file system and its implementation. That is going to be our next topic, major topic of this course. Maybe two or three class maximum, and then I'll end up the course. If other courses have finished the syllabus, so I don't want to do that. And most of the UG courses, they stop at this point. So that is what I'm also going to follow. So hopefully you will be able to take any exams with OS courses with all the concepts that we have discussed.